Welcome to the Average Report, everybody. I am Brett Erlich. It is, I'll get to what day it is in a second. Brooke Thomas is here. Brooke, did you hear?
It's the 21st, right?
Today, I don't know what the date is. I want to say the 21st.
It's the 21st.
For those of you listening to the podcast, do you know what happened yesterday on the show when John introduced the beginning of the—
No.
John spent the first, we call them blocks in television.
Yes.
He spent the entire first block just talking about how Friday it was. When the show was getting edited, our editor Cassie came over and was like, guys, is there something I don't know about?
Like, what is John, is this a Friday show or something?
It seems like everything he's saying is Friday.
It was John's Friday. Basically, he wasn't thinking about anything else.
Oh, John checked out on Wednesday.
Yes.
That's not true. John does not check out.
He didn't even check. He was sending an email last night.
Right. He talked about how Friday it was and all the stuff that's happening between now and the time he's back to live television. But what was hilarious is that he just went so into Friday, which is the most like mentally checked out you can be.
Right.
And then the segment right after that was just like, boom, it was like right in there.
He was ready.
Absolutely fantastic, which is the perfect way to describe my friend John, where you can be so on point with all your political points. And then there's these delightful moments where he's like, it's Friday.
But does John ever give us one of those?
No, I wish.
I wish. It would be funny. I wish. You too. You two should have done Hostmates.
What's me and John?
Mm-hmm. It would have maybe not been as entertaining because people like a train wreck, but
I loved you.
You would have had the opportunity to win.
Yeah, for those of you who don't know, members, and this is a good opportunity to talk about what members get between now and the new year, but members of TYT. Hostmates is a show that we did a special where we tried to see which TYT Hostmates, like duos, Anna and Cenk, Ben and Michael, JR and Rick, and then Brooke and John, which of them knew each other the best. And I'd say the most disadvantaged were the two of you because you've known each other the least amount of time compared to, say, Ben and Michael, who've known each other for 36 years or something like
but
that.
But also, to be fair to the game, we have known each other longer than it appears we do.
Yes. Yes.
It appears we met yesterday.
Yes.
From our performance.
Right. That is, there's just an amazing, you gotta watch, you gotta sign up to become a member to do that since Brooke is beating me.
It is tyt.com/Brooke. And so there's an E at the end of my name, so it's Brooke, so it's B-R-O-O-K-E.
And if you don't wanna have some stupid ass names, oh, come on, control room. Brooke is too difficult to spell.
Am I beating you? What are we, like one and two?
last time I checked, you had 9 and I had 6.
Oh, it's tight.
This feels so much like a morning show right now. I love
this
it.
This is, it's Friday.
I wish I was in my jammies, but here is no. For those of you listening to the podcast, they have faded slowly to tyt.com/Brett. It's very clear they do support me, tyt.com/Brett. For people to sign up, we're having a membership drive. These are the waning days of the membership drive for people who want to sign up. What do you get? There it is, finally.
There we go, and that's such a cute picture. But just to be clear, so tyt.com/Brett is a thing, but if you actually want to sign up, you would go to tyt.com/Brooke.
All right, I'm not gonna win on this. I give up. another thing that's for members, next week we have already pre-shot some year-end specials. John mentioned this yesterday on Friday's show. We did some pre-shot specials. Brooke will be co-hosting one.
Yay!
I will be co-hosting one. And then the other one is a look back. So there's the year in damage, which Brooke was on. There is the awards show that we did to give out our awards for the best and worst of the year, which John and I did together. And then we take a look back on our favorite interviews from throughout the year, or at least the most important ones, a mix of the two. But they're all great. So check that out. And members get that early. So people who are members, as soon as they're done getting edited, they're up there for on demand for people who are members. Everyone who's watching the live feed on Roku and the TYT network on YouTube TV, you guys will still be able to see it. It'll just be live, broadcast live, the same normal time, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday of next week. So that's all the business of what's happening behind the scenes here at TYT that you can be part of. We need to get into the news. We have a huge news day. We're gonna talk about the government shutdown and things that are still happening right now on the floor of the Senate as it goes to them. We're gonna talk about that. In addition, we're also gonna talk about some hilarious alternative means by which people are seeking to fund the government. Specifically, the border wall that has come between Donald Trump and Christmas vacation, essentially. And then we're also gonna talk about this crazy story in Alabama where there's essentially American meddling in our elections. We'll get into some of the behind the scenes stuff of that. And then marijuana, maybe some time for Ben Shapiro, but definitely some gift ideas for people who are looking to give something to that special Trump fan in all of us. And then our Christmas list for what we want. So it's a packed show. But we have to get to something before we get into like the nitty gritty of the show. This just broke this morning. Ruth Bader Ginsburg is having medical procedures done on her. There was a report that you might have remembered that she took a fall in November and she broke some ribs. They took her into the doctors and the doctors did some tests and found some cancerous nodularity happening in her pulmonary area, so her lungs. And she news broke today amid this crazy government shutdown news that she had some cancerous nodularity removed from her lungs. The prognosis is that she's gonna be okay and there is no remaining disease there. But what a terrifying, there was so much crazy news yesterday. There's been so much going on, but Ruth Bader Ginsburg, am I alone in thinking we have to keep her alive by any means necessary?
No, for sure. And she's so well loved. She's so well loved. She's so well liked. And she's such a good person, you know? And so, but just outside of the fact that, you know, in politics, you want this judge that's, you know, really fighting for basic humanity to be able to stay in that position. Outside of all of that, it's just the fact that, you know, this is a woman that, you know, we don't want anything to happen to. This is a woman that we all know so much about and we all care about. And we don't want anything, we want her to be healthy.
Yeah, she's 85 years old. She is the oldest Supreme Court justice currently sitting. I mean, I am pulling for her because, of course, the people who saw the whole Brett Kavanaugh thing play out, the Antonin Scalia, Merrick Garland, all those things. The Supreme Court is so very important and should, God forbid, things should happen to her. God knows who Trump would appoint, but I mean, I guess it isn't just God knows because he already has released like a list of people. All we know is it probably won't be Merrick Garland. But our thoughts, prayers, get well soon.
Yes. Whatever your thing is, send it her way.
Yes, if you need to do some kind of ritual, I'm open to it. Some kind of satanic chanting.
All right, all right.
As long as it keeps her alive, I'm all for it.
Okay. Out of control.
Now we get on to the government shutdown. Okay, so this government shutdown thing, what is it? What's happening? How did we get here? Okay, so all Trump wants for Christmas essentially is the wall. He ran on a platform from day one of saying that immigration is his number one priority. He said that the day he announced his presidency and followed up shortly thereafter with, you know, they're not sending their best, they're sending rapists to America. And so he wants at least $5 billion for his border wall. Now, that's something that he said. It's been 2 years to get $5 billion out of the $20 billion that he wants for the ultimate construction of this. It's been 2 years and he hasn't gotten it. And what has happened essentially within like the Congress is the Congress has gone along and just said, you know what? We're going to say he's fighting for this wall, but there's not enough votes to get the money for it. They got close. We've already shut the government down over it. And it seemed like, and then there was a vote in the House or in the Senate, and the Senate took like a voice vote where they said all in favor of this other agreement that we have, where we essentially are just saying you get all the money to fund the government minus the border wall. There was a vote on the House where they said all in favor say aye, and they said aye, it was unanimous. But then things kind of changed. It seemed like there weren't going to be enough votes. And Sarah Huckabee Sanders started hinting that they would find other ways to fund this wall. She said, in the meantime, we're looking at every avenue available to us possible. The president has asked every one of his cabinet secretaries to look for funding that can be used to protect our borders. At the end of the day, we don't want to shut down the government. We want to shut down the border from illegal immigration. So then the Donald Trump was starting to listen to people like Laura Ingraham. And Laura Ingraham came out and essentially told everyone, you know what? Trump's being a little lily-livered, you know, pushover and he isn't fighting for his wall. And then suddenly Trump came back and said, you know what? We're gonna fight really hard for this wall to the death. And now there's gonna be a shutdown because he said he won't accept what's happening.
And also this wall that he knows he cannot get. It is not going to happen. He knows that. And it's just for looks now. There's so much about this. You know, obviously the most important thing about this is that this is not about illegal immigration. This is not about border security. This is about throwing gasoline on a racism fire. And that's really what this is about. But, and kind of like keeping that those that base of people that really like that fire, like kind of, you know, excited. But there's so many lies about this every day. Like, doesn't it always should just like come back in people's minds that he said Mexico was paying for this. And so now we are going to shut the federal government down for because we're not agreeing to pay for something that he said Mexico was going to pay for. And the people who are in support of this don't care that, do you know what I mean? Like, don't care that we're, that was a lie and that was an obvious lie. And like, it's.
Yes, it's, we'll get into a little bit more. We got to take a quick break right now. When we come back, we're going to talk about what's happening right now today on the Senate floor about this. What Mitch McConnell's saying, what Chuck Schumer's saying. Are the votes there? Is it an exercise in futility? As well as other things that Trump's base that you're talking about is trying to do to fund this wall. Come hell or high water, don't go away. More damage report after this.
We need to talk about a relatively new show called the Republic, or UNFTR. As a Young Turks fan, you already know that the government, the media, and corporations are constantly peddling lies that serve the interests of the rich and powerful. But now there's a podcast dedicated to unraveling those lies, debunking the conventional wisdom. In each episode of the Republic, or UNFTR, the host delves into a different historical episode or topic that's generally misunderstood or purposely obfuscated by the so-called powers that be, featuring in-depth research, razor-sharp commentary, and just the right amount of vulgarity. The UNFTR podcast takes a sledgehammer to what you thought you knew about some of the nation's most sacred historical cows. But don't just take my word for it. The New York Times described UNFTR as consistently compelling and educational, aiming to challenge conventional wisdom and upend the historical narratives that were taught in school. For as the great philosopher Yoda once put it,
"You must unlearn what you have learned."
And that's true whether you're in Jedi training or you're uprooting and exposing all the propaganda and disinformation you've been fed over the course of your lifetime. So search for UNFDR in your podcast app today and get ready to get informed, angered, and entertained all at the same time.
Welcome back to the Damage Report. We're going to pick up right where we left off. Brooke was talking about the base of Trump and how they'll pretty much rally around, or we're trying to figure out just how serious they are about rallying around the Trump border wall. Mm-hmm. Here's what Ann Coulter, I said it, Laura Ingraham, she's later in the show, but here's what Ann Coulter said to rally the base. She said, either Trump never invented or intended to build a wall and was scamming voters from the beginning, or he hasn't the first idea in how to get it done and no interest in finding out. My prediction is his support will evaporate and Trump will very likely not finish his term and definitely not be elected to a second term. So two things happened.
Okay.
First, it seems that Trump got the message and he started sending out information and trying to rally folks around this new initiative that he had to stop the government unless he got his border funding. Here is a video that he played, or that he made.
"I'm fighting very hard for border security, so important. I've already started building the wall. We built large sections and we're fixing up a lot of other sections that are a mess. But the fact is, we need the wall. The Democrats know it. Everybody knows it. It's only a game when they say you don't need the wall. You can look at their eyes and you can say, well, they're not telling the truth. They want to try and do anything possible to hurt us because of the fact it's politics. I understand that."
You know, it's an edited video. You can take another stab at it.
Right. We don't need the wall. That's the fact. We don't.
Yeah. And here's the other thing
Everybody
that happened.
Needs diversity training, okay?
Donald Trump also, according to Trump Alert, after Ann Coulter made that statement online, real Donald Trump appears to no longer follow Ann Coulter. This bot cannot tell if it was an unfollow, suspension, or block, but no longer does real Donald Trump follow Ann Coulter, so he's very upset.
So much of this is just based on appearances, and that's so harmful and useless. It's worthless. It's pitiful. So much of all of this is just based on appearances, how one looks, and it's this, you know, it's corny.
Right, so here, this is essentially, It was a decision between two things, right? One, to just go with what had been happening before. Because this is the last chance that he has with a Republican-dominated Congress in both houses. And after this, Nancy Pelosi takes over in the House, and there's really no chance of him ever getting this funding for this border wall. So he had the decision essentially between letting the continuing resolution go on so people could go home for Christmas, or digging his feet in the dirt and going ahead and saying, we're going to shut down the government. He said it to Nancy Pelosi. He doubled down. This morning he was even tweeting, like, the Democrats own this shutdown. He was also saying that Mitch McConnell needed to use the nuclear option in order to get this passed.
He also, like, remember they had this disastrous conversation on national television, which blew all of our minds.
Yeah.
Where he basically said, like, he was putting it on them and on a Congress that wouldn't start until January. He was putting it on them because, you know, he couldn't pass it right now. And she was saying, do it. No, he was saying he could pass it right now. And she's like, well, do it.
Yeah.
Do it.
You can.
He's like, yes, I can. Well, okay, we'll do it.
So the Senate was like, listen, the Senate's the hard one. We're going to do a budget that doesn't fund the wall. But it does give $1.3 billion for security measures when it comes to border security. And then Chuck Schumer actually went on the floor of the Senate today and said, listen, they haven't spent last year's border security allocation. So why is he asking for more money now if he hasn't spent what we've given him in the past? That is proof that this is all a ruse, and all he's trying to do is get this stuff. And
that's the most important point of all of this, just what he said, just that.
I mean, I personally think that Trump could have just said, and he was trying to, he was like, listen, when I say it's not a concrete wall, I want a beautiful artistically designed wall that's a bunch of steel pillars in there, just declare victory and move on. That's what he should do. I don't know what's
stopping
him.
That's what it's about. Just say you did it. Don't harm all these people and shut the government down.
Yep.
For attention.
So now,
a fence is not a wall, but sure.
It's fine.
If it stops all of this, sure.
He said this. This is another tweet that I really love. He said, the Democrats are trying to belittle the concept of a wall, calling it old-fashioned. The fact is there is nothing else that will work, and that has been true for thousands of years. It's like the wheel. There is nothing better. Then he says, I know tech better than anyone, and technology on a border is only effective in conjunction with a wall. So then he goes on and says it's 99% successful in Israel. It will not be any different from on our southern border, hundreds of billions saved.
That's just not something that I want to compare. Like, it's not what I
Yeah, just, it's a shorter border. I mean, the vast majority of people who come to the country not through the border, and they overstay their visas. It's just, to him, it is just emblematic of something that he wants to have because he said he wanted to have it.
But even saying that, he said that for a reason. Just that, even that statement. And it wasn't even about the wall,
Yeah. There are other ways that people are going about trying to get funding for the wall in the event that he is not able to rally around it. Brian Colfage started a GoFundMe for a wall to see if people will sign up and give their cash to it.
It was at 7 million last night.
Last night it was 7.4 million. And really the only reason that I chose to use this graphic, it's because it's a photo of Trump enormous in front of a wall. I don't even know where that is, but it's "We the People will fund the wall," and Trump's giving a huge thumbs up. That was last night. Mm-hmm. Now it's at $11.7 million.
Just overnight.
Overnight.
It's jumped up $4 million.
Yep. And so the creator of this, Brian Colfage, went on, he went on Laura Ingraham's show to explain, and Laura had some questions for him.
It's not going to even make a dent in the total cost, which would be at least around $20 billion. I'm not great at math, but that's a pretty tough hill to climb.
I would like to stop it right here. Brian Colfage is a triple amputee, and she's talking about climbing hills. Good job, Laura. But she went on to ask him, this question.
So what do you say to those critics?
I say that they're full of crap, and, you know, this is the United States and we can do anything we want. And if people want to donate to that wall and give their money, they can do it. I mean, what's $80 for 60 million people? The common person can give that kind of money. And, you know, this is not just about Republicans and conservatives. There's an outpouring of Democrats that are messaging me and giving to this wall fund. It's from both sides of the aisle, but you don't hear the liberal media saying that. This is America coming together. They want the wall.
So the average person doesn't have $83 in this country. The common person that he's talking about doesn't. And he's like, you know, if all of Trump's people who voted for Trump like could give $83, he got all those votes because voting is free. Okay? Most of those people don't have $83 extra, which is literally why they ran. Like, it's just, it's all, no, and a lot, and even more of those people now, you know, let's say all the people that are, that work at Harley Davidson, maybe now they, maybe they had $83 before the election.
Yeah.
They don't now.
Yeah, so like, that is.
It's just so elitist.
So that's on the, do people have $80 to give? Specifically when he talks about people on the Democratic side, that's just not true. People, not most of America, likes this wall. CBS News polling from mid-November found that a majority, 59% of Americans, oppose building a wall along the US-Mexico border. It's a partisan issue though. A large majority of Republicans support the wall, 79%. A majority of independents, 66% of independents oppose the wall, and 84% of Democrats are also against it. So that is factually incorrect. But you can go on Fox and say whatever you want, and they're gonna echo it no matter what.
Like, just on GoFundMe, just if he had just like scrolled down GoFundMe before he made that statement, he would see the number of people who are trying to fund their medical care.
Well, that's the thing.
On that same website. You know, the people you're yelling at don't have $83. It's just all a mess, but sure. I mean, what?
Just really quickly, people who are looking to put their money somewhere else, there is another GoFundMe that's out there that is a counter GoFundMe to buy ladders to get over Trump's wall. It has raised $74,011, and the person who created it said, "We saw some folks raising money for a border wall to keep out our migrant siblings and fellow human beings who are fleeing violence and persecution. So they want to build, get money for a wall so folks can go and climb over it because they are fleeing persecution." And also, they pointed out, and we don't have a graphic for this, but even though at a rate of $1.7 million daily, it would take their fund about 35 years to raise the $21.7 billion. That is pretty much a conservative estimate for how much it would take to build a wall, much less maintain a wall.
Right, so then we need even more money when we got there. But it's, you know, this is, okay, all right.
Yep, all right, so we'll keep you posted on TYT, watch the main show later today, see if there's any resolution to the vote on the Senate floor to fund the wall or not. It looked like it was an exercise in futility because there are not 60 votes. However, we'll see based on how many people were actually physically able to get back to Washington to vote on this, because a lot of them had gone home. Some of them in Congress were seen singing Christmas carols after they passed the first resolution, which they thought would go through very easily. Don't go away. We got a lot more damage report after this. We'll be back. Welcome back to the Damage Report. Brad Ehrlich here with Brooke Thomas. John Ederle is somewhere in the country, and if you can find him, I'll give you $20. That's not true. I will not do that. And please don't go find him.
Please don't go find him.
That was really creepy. So strange. Okay, so we're going to move on to our next story. This is a crazy story that is so weird, but also kind of is a glimpse into what political consultants are and are not trying as we move into this uncharted land of social media's influence on political campaigns. Okay, so you may remember Doug Jones won his senatorial race against Roy Moore. Doug Jones, this is the Alabama Senate race that took place after Jeff Sessions was made attorney general, and Luther Strange, who was supposed to be the guy who took over afterwards, lost the primary to Roy Moore, who is that guy who put the Ten Commandments in the, you know, state courthouse and all that. So here is what happened during that election. The New York Times reports that there was a certain group that used Russia-style tactics in terms of fake Facebook groups, and we'll get into that in a second, in order to try to influence the election, and not necessarily influence it greatly, but see if the same dynamics that worked ostensibly for the Russians could also work for political consultants within the United States. So the project's operators created a Facebook page on which they posed as conservative Alabamians, using it to try to divide Republicans and even to endorse a write-in candidate to draw votes from Moore. According to the report itself, it says, "We orchestrated an elaborate false flag operation that planted the idea that the Moore campaign was amplified on social media by a Russian botnet." So they did that. And some of the results are actually kind of crazy. They talked to the guy that was propped up essentially by this Facebook group to try to raise his social media profile by having what was essentially a pro-Democrat Facebook group masquerading as a Republican Facebook group that is mad at the Moore campaign for you, blah, 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 blah. And what they were able to do was improve this guy's Twitter handle from having 100 followers to 10,000 Twitter followers.
That's wild, right.
So crazy. Now, what do consultants in America think of this? Because this was kind of it was actually funded by Reid Hoffman, who created LinkedIn, but it was a bunch of people who have had all kinds of influence and roles within American politics. But here is what non-affiliated people who weren't involved in this, but just outside consultants are saying about it. Dan Bayans, who's a GOP consultant in Kentucky, said some will do whatever it takes to win. You've got Russia, which showed folks how to do it. You've got consultants willing to engage in this type of behavior and political leaders who apparently find it futile to stop it. That's on the right side. Joe Trippi, who was overseeing the Roy Moore campaign, said, I think the big danger is somebody in this cycle uses the dark arts of bots and social networks, and it works, then we're in real trouble. So the question is, like, they're talking about the futility of trying to stop this kind of stuff. I guess the question is, like, if there are fake accounts out there that manage to convince people of falsehoods, is that something? I mean, maybe not necessarily saying that the Russians are backing someone, but at least masquerading as people on your side to pull you away from your side to do something that actually hurts your side. I mean, what's your take on that?
I mean, I think just their responses to this and the reaction to this is fascinating because that is the audience of their base. Mm-hmm. You know, the people who say Hillary Clinton has killed, you know, 60 people secretly.
Oh,
and
God.
And Pizzagate and things like that.
Frazzle drip.
Right. And no one cares until it starts to happen to you. There's not that thought process until it actually happens. There's not that just process of, you know what, this is a weird thing to do. This is not okay. This is a slippery slope. This is not okay for anybody when they're winning. Like that, like Roy Moore himself would never come out against that when we're talking about the president, what happened with the president and what our social media has looked like for the past 3 years
right.
because of this. But now, you know, he's got, you know, someone who worked on his campaign saying, hey, this is terrible. This is not okay. And I just want to say, where have you all been?
Yeah, it's terrifying. I mean, this is crazy because, like, okay, there's a lot of differences between like Russian meddling in a campaign and right. American meddling in a campaign. That's one thing I would say if it was a choice between people who are meddling, I would rather have Americans than Russians. But that's kind of difficult to say because it's still people utterly lying.
Right.
Also, there's the fact that lying happens all the damn time.
That is true.
Like, definitely watch our year-end special that's coming up next week where we talk about the worst ads. There was that Duncan Hunter ad against Amar Kamp in a jar that essentially said that he's trying to hide the fact that he's a Muslim with the name Amar Kamp in a jar, but also lying about his family and lying about his role as a terrorist. This stuff happens all the time. What is okay? What is not okay? I think a lot of people here would say, listen, as long as if we get money out of politics, then it'll hamstring the people who have the resources to launch these expensive, counter campaigns. But it's so fascinating to me because it's essentially trying with tribalism in America, you have two sides. And if anyone identifies me as on the opposite side of you, they're instantly not going to pay attention to it. But I think definitely not using these weird bot tactics. But if you set up a fake account that lays out from the perspective of like someone who is voting Republican typically, but also you make like a kind of economic populist argument to them in their voice, even though it's not actually their voice, like that could work. That's the way around tribalism. And the argument could ostensibly be like, it's a sound argument. The only lie was like, who was saying it? But like the logic still holds. And that's all we've been trying to do on the left. And I'm sure that's what people on the right have been trying to do who are earnest, are saying like, I'm trying to give you just an argument as to why this is in your favor. I don't know. I mean, what do you think about it?
That's just, it's like hard to put into words, which is weird because that's kind of my job. But
Well, listen, the report does not say whether the project purchased the Russian bot Twitter accounts that suddenly began to follow Mr. Moore, but it takes credit for radicalizing Democrats with a Russian bot scandal and points to stories on the phenomenon in the mainstream media. Roy Moore flooded with a fake Russian Twitter followers. That's what the New York Times said. Then this one thing, just to kind of bring it home. There is a quote from Mark Twain that I think is really awesome. In this time where I feel like everyone's been fooled and I want to tell them that they've been fooled, he has this quote that's like, how easy it is to make people believe a lie and hard it is to undo that work again.
It's so true.
And a lot of people, the version you'll see in memes is like, it's easier to fool someone than to convince them that they've been fooled. And this seems, yes, of course, it's so ridiculous and terrible, but at least as an experiment, and they say it did not truly affect the entire campaign and the results. The guy got a couple hundred write-in votes, the total write-in, there were a couple hundred write-in votes. Other people like Condoleezza Rice, Jeff Sessions, and Jesus Christ got more write-in votes. But it's just one of those crazy behind-the-scenes things that you're seeing, like, people doesn't and campaigns
that,
work on.
Look, doesn't that come off kind of irresponsible to you?
Oh,
or
yeah.
Just me? Because it's kind of like, oh, fire's cool, let's touch it. Like that's, and that is, no, don't touch it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like that there's a different, I don't know, just like what you can learn from this and just the harm of doing it and kind of furthering it. It seems like those, they're not equal.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's where we are.
We have to take a break. When we come back, a lot more damage report. Don't go away. We'll see you on the other side. Welcome back, everybody. Let's talk about marijuana.
Okay, sure. Okay.
For people who are living in New York, that lawless city on a hill, who don't enjoy the recreational marijuana that we do here in California, things are about to change and you're about to move into the 21st century. The developments have been taking place over the last few days. And essentially, the mayor or the governor, Andrew Cuomo, went and he said on in a speech, he said this, the fact is, we have had two criminal justice systems, one for the wealthy and well-off, and one for everyone else. The system has, for too long, targeted the African-American and minority communities. Let's legalize the adult use of medical marijuana once and for all. And then the mayor doubled down and said, legalization done the right way will marry opportunity with justice. We have a chance to create a brand new industry that will lift up everyday New Yorkers. And we have a chance to choke off corporate America in the process and not let them get their greedy hands on this industry here in the state. So there's two points there.
Yeah.
I was just going to say, it's two approaches.
Mm-hmm.
One is there's been a lot of people who have been put in prison because we've criminalized medical marijuana. And what do we do about it? And the other one is, so if we are opening up the doors for a new industry here, who's going to be in charge of it? Because in the meantime, there have been a lot of small growers and mom and pop shops that have put together, their little storefront and sold weed. Even though it's like not completely legal, they've done it for medicinal purposes. Even though the thing is designed to look like your average head shop,
right?
But what do we do with those two things?
I mean, I think, so that's something that's not being discussed in cities as this is being legalized. Kind of in the argument is, the first point that you had, the argument is that, all those people that are in jail or all those people who have, crimes and who have records because of marijuana, they were breaking the law at the time. So we don't want to change that. We're just starting over. But is it possible that it could be looked at as, now we've realized that this was a stupid law, and so those people just were ahead of the time.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's like it either is something that should be criminal or not. And if you've decided that this shouldn't be criminal, then all of those people, before when it was a criminal, you have to come out and admit that that maybe was a mistake, that, times change. And there are lots of things that we did before that we realized were wrong and we apologize for them. And also those same people who were, because even when marijuana was legal, there were disparities when it comes to who was being punished for it and drugs in general. And so,
and especially in New York City with stop and frisk,
and
they
what
would
Rudy
just,
Giuliani did to the city and to the criminal justice system in the city and black and brown people. And
and if you had any weed on you whatsoever, you would instantly be apprehended and taken in for things that they chalked up to cleaning up the streets. But it was just like this weird, racist, unconstitutional way of trying to get what they called a clean city, but was just super duper racist.
And it wasn't even just about having weed on you. A lot of times it was about being black or being brown, and then you would get pulled over, you would get stopped,
right,
and frisked. And then they would find something, but there were no the probable cause was being black or brown.
Right.
And so that's how, you know, a lot of this kind of started.
Yeah.
They find stuff on you like during a search that really is probably a little unconstitutional. We're clear about that now.
Yeah.
But we weren't then.
And now there are 10 states that have truly legal recreational marijuana. That list is ever growing. De Blasio, what was crazy for me to learn is that for the first time in a decade, only now, the entire state legislature of New York is Democratic. And there's a lot of upstate people, but there's so many folks living in Manhattan, and it seems like it's the Senate finally shifted. So now that it is, now it will be Democratic. And De Blasio and Cuomo really want to get out ahead of it. So when everyone comes back in January, for the new session, that everyone's ready to go. So that's good for them.
Fascinating. And this is all kind of like Cynthia Nixon's platform that I didn't really hear much coming from them before that. But it, you know.
But that's literally right. You're yeah, absolutely right. That was one of the things that in the wake of the Cynthia Nixon run for for governor, that people were like, well, what? I feel like we worked so hard and we didn't get anything. Literally, as a result of her candidacy, De Blasio Cuomo
yeah,
had to shift. He shifted his entire policy on this, and now they're ready to go. And
because he's had years to say what he said a couple days ago. He's had years to say this.
Yeah, it's $1.7 billion industry that he could create just by making it legal.
Yeah,
and no one gets hurt. It's not one of those things that makes you become violent. If anything, it just makes you kind of hungry and sleepy. I learned recently about the difference between indica and sativa.
Recently?
Yeah, and I needed a mnemonic device, and I hadn't heard anything like indica couch. That's what they say. Indica is the one that makes you fall into the couch. I'm getting a lot of thumbs up. The hybrid is powered by electricity, from what I understand.
Okay.
All right. Okay, so we're gonna move on to another story. This one is just a little thing I saw from Ben Shapiro in Newsweek. It started out, apparently he watched CBS News, and it said, this week America learned about something the millennials can like to call adulting, which is the most Ben Shapiro quote ever, because it's like, this week America learned. And this proves that when Ben Shapiro writes something about millennials, he is telling it to grandparents, because it's like a CBS nightly news thing, and he's like, well, we all learned, and then it's just very frustrating. He says, while speculation has run rampant that economic hardship has forced millennials to stay home longer and thus to fail to adult, student loan costs and housing costs are generally blamed for millennial economic hardship. The truth is that we've simply become lazier as parents, essentially this old argument that we're coddling kids and not giving them things to struggle over. He says Americans aren't expected to start building a life, particularly middle and upper class Americans, until they're nearing their 30s. There are many Americans who make decisions that force them into adulthood. Single mothers, for example, aren't going to be taking adulting classes. But the question is how we can encourage young people to adult in non-circumstance driven fashions. He's like, you know, people become single mothers and they have to learn how to adult. We don't want to make them do that, but how can we make them? And he says later in his article, how do we make them suffer so that they'll grow up faster?
A broken clock is right twice a day, so we know that.
Mm-hmm.
This is maybe one of those instances. I don't know if I would call like any parent lazy. That I, you know, I'm not a parent yet, and so it's a weird like judgment to have.
Right.
But this absolutely, when I saw the story about the adulting classes, that's your job as a parent. That's what parents are supposed to do. But he mentioned single mothers like after the fact, so like the millennials that would be single mothers and how like they're forced into parenting. But what about, so single mothers can't take parenting classes, but what about the single mothers who can't teach a parenting class because of everything that they have to do outside of the home to keep the home like to existing?
We used to have things that taught you how to do this in high school, by the way.
That
and
is
those
true.
Got unfunded, and we don't have money for them, mm-hmm. and that's a problem. Also, this concept of adolescence that he is vilifying, by the way, is something that was utterly fetishized in the 1950s when you thought, and invented essentially, and fetishized in the 1950s, the time that you think is the golden age. And what's the problem with solving problems? That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to eliminate suffering, and mm-hmm. he wants to create it so you can teach people a lesson. I think, in the words of Sterling Archer, I can do both. All right, we got to take a break. When we come back, we're going to go through our Christmas list. It's going to be awesome. Don't go away. Welcome back to the last few minutes of the show. It's the holidays. There's a lot that you have to do in the holidays. You have to buy a lot of presents. And what do you get for that Trump supporter in your family? We have some suggestions. First, the deporter mug. That is for people who see Trump as a super agent.
Does that then deport the Trump supporter in your
life? It might. It might. There's another. There's so many Trump colognes that I've found. One is called, I forget which one is this, Empire. Empire by Trump for $4.40. The best are the descriptions of it. At first, I expected the product to have a harsh smell, the smell of expensive cigar smoke, whiskey, and wild women. When you think Empire, you think power. The fragrance is actually quite sensual and took me by surprise. A very light petal of mist, the smell of honest luxury.
Okay, Bigley. Okay.
Someone said, it lasts 6 to 8 hours on my skin. I do get my fair share of compliments from attractive women. I've been rocking this thing for the last 3 weeks. And wow, I love wearing Trump's success with a suit. It gives you an overwhelming feeling of confidence and arrogance, like you can tackle anything that comes your way. It's like you are the boss. It doesn't matter if you are like the guy or not. Trump's success is a straight up winner. Oh, that's for Trump's success. That's the next one. That you can buy for $22. I want to skip the next graphic and go to the Trump toilet paper you can buy. So we can kiss your buns if you're interested. And then there's also a Trump toilet brush for those of you who are interested in making your toilet.
Okay, so these are not for the Trump supporters in your life. This is now we're going.
I think the Trump supporter would like that, right? It's a Trump thing and it cleans up messy situations.
Okay. I'm a fan of a disposable toilet bowl cleaner. Just
one and done. I have the one that you put in, you wipe it, and then you push the button and it goes in the toilet.
Yeah.
But it's like just the very end is disposable.
That's true.
And the last one that I really think summarized everything was the Trump fart toy. It says, I fart and say 7 outrageous and hilarious sayings. Some of which are, let's see if I have it right here, because I don't want to misquote him. Here's my next, this one is like, fart, I'll make Mexico pay for that one too. Fart, ooh, that one was made in China. And take this, Putin, fart. So that one farts at the end.
Okay.
So there's that. What do you want for Christmas? What's on your
every
news wish
single
Christmas list?
Child who is still separated from their parents at the border or somewhere randomly in the United States to be back with them.
Yeah. That's great.
That's a good idea, right?
That is an earnest, non-jokey one, and I appreciate that.
Yeah.
And that's the stuff. It's like so much stuff has happened throughout the year that it's so easy to just forget about.
Yeah.
And people, like, Thursday's news was crazy. Thursday, we're getting a shutdown in one day, and the defense secretary quit. That was one day's news.
Yeah.
And then you think about what happened earlier in that week, and we were talking about artistic walls before that, and so much is that there's still children who are separated from their family. Is that all you want?
I mean, like when it comes to like new stuff.
New stuff, that's really great. That's awesome. For those of you who are trying to give the gift of progressivism this holiday season, don't forget that you can support putting progressives on key committees in the new session of Congress. Rashida Tlaib for appropriations, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Pramila Jayapal, and Ro Khanna for ways and means. Pramila Jayapal also for judiciary. Katie Porter for financial services. They're supported by a whole bunch of people. Justice Democrats put out this. And to add your support, you can go to justicedemocrats.com/key committees. And you can go and issue your support so that people actually do get on those committees so they can make a positive change.
Wait, what do you want?
What do I want? I wrote it down. Oh, I want Yellies. I don't know if you guys saw Yellies. It's the best Christmas gift ever. Take a look. Yellies are first of all, I want Medicare for all, and I want all those people on those key committees. But I want Yellies. Yellies are a toy that in order to make them work, you scream at them. That is the operative way to make the Yellies go. And the child, like, imagine, give this to your family who has kids and then get the hell out of that house. All right, that's it for this episode of the Damage Report. John will be back next week with some specials, so will we. And then also this weekend, Sunday on ABC News at 9 p.m. to 11 p.m., I'll be on a special. See you next time.
Yes!
Thanks for listening to the full episode of The Damage Report. Support our work, listen ad-free, access members-only bonus content, and more by subscribing to Apple Podcasts at apple.co/TYT. I'm your host, John Adirola. I'll see you soon.